I know you're a big proponent of taking stock of our finances all year round.
Yes.
But as we go into the spring season, there's this, I guess, notion of a fresh start and this spring cleaning when it comes to our homes and everything around us. So I want to bring in our finances. And I guess I want to start with, you probably have a tax return or some kind of a tax return, or you're expecting that tax return.
Yes.
What should you be doing with that?
So you're right. People are going through their home, they're looking to clean things up, and as they have that trash bin there, I want them to also have a shredder, because a lot of people do not realize how important it is that if a document even has your name, has an address on it, that can be enough for identity thieves to start something in play. Now, you take into the factor that you do have those notices of assessment coming in, all of those, maybe your T4, T5, all those things hanging around that have your social insurance number on them, key component to your identity that can trip off identity theft. So have a part of your home that you dedicate to these documents, your SIN card. They're not even issuing SIN cards anymore because it's such a key component to your identity. But know where you are, know where all of those documents are when you come back from your accountant. Put them under lock and key at home, because unfortunately a growing trend is friendly fraud, where it's a housekeeper, an ex-nanny, spouse, an assistant, something of that sort.
So Fraud Prevention Month was in March, but
yes,
this is something that's like ongoing, like year round. You should always stay on top of that.
Yeah.
I'm wondering though, once you get that tax return in and you have that little bit of a windfall, if I can call it, you mentioned RESP, what else should we be looking at? What should we be doing with that money?
Yes. Now, ideally, you have the notion that that is not a windfall, because it's in fact the government giving you your money back without any interest. So hopefully you've sat down with a professional like a certified financial planner and you know already where that money should be going. Maybe the strategy was to put some money into an RSP, to generate a tax refund, to put down on your mortgage. I don't know, I'm just making this up. That might have been for you. And you've forgotten that from the time that your planner set that out, and the money comes in and you spend it and have fun with it. By all means, if it's not earmarked for something and you've budgeted that that is going to be the vacation for you and your family, what have you, but it shouldn't be a windfall. Like at the end of the day, this is where we do funny things with pots of money. People will view their RSP or their TFSA or their tax refund as different pots of money. Meanwhile, it's all your money. It should be fitting within a plan. If it is a surprise, sit on it for a little while. I got a small inheritance myself, and I have to say that the personal, my first instinct was, what am I going to buy? Because I'm a spender. I have to use nudges to curtail myself. And I know a lot of Canadians feel that same way. But once it becomes your money, after a few weeks, after a few months, and you just sit on it, sometimes your lens is very different. So if you are a spender too, and that tax refund comes in, ideally get a plan. And if you know that you're a spender, commit to sitting on it for 2 to 4 weeks before you spend anything.
Speaking of spending, keeping up with the Joneses is a big thing that you always write about. And getting into that spring, summer season, I really want that new patio set.
Uh-huh.
I really need that brand new barbecue. I need all of that.
Yes.
That's a big component, keeping up with the Joneses, taking a look at what your neighbors are doing, taking a look at what the people around you are buying and spending on.
I like your wording, how you said, I need that. You didn't say, I want that. And I don't want to be the message of doom and gloom. I always talk about choice and awareness, that it's not about sacrifice. Because like a diet, if you have to stick to something, you're going to just lose it. And you're going to buy whatever you want. But if it's a lifestyle choice, and again, you've planned for spring is coming, summer holidays are coming, whatever's happening in the fall, and you save in anticipation for that, there's nothing wrong with the spending of it. But it's really stopping and thinking that, just a few decades ago and for all of time, especially before credit cards and lines of credit and all these fancy things that banks have introduced us that we don't think about, if you were poor, you looked poor, and if you were rich, you looked rich. Today, there is absolutely no way that the average Canadian can know if they're comparing themselves to their neighbors and saying, wow, I hear this from Canadians across the country saying, how is everyone else making it? How do they have that second car, the great vacation, the new patio furniture, anything that they want? And then, of course, social media just amplifies these great, fantastic moments of when you're in Rome and your spouse is and all these wonderful things. Meanwhile, when you pull the curtains back, they may be in crippling debt because 50% of Canadians are $200 away from being able to pay their bills. The Financial Planning Standards Council revealed recently that 1 in 5 Canadians couldn't make it 1 week before going into debt to pay their bills. So then when you hear that, you're like, oh, maybe the person you're comparing yourself to, trying to keep up with, is in fact not doing very well, and that's not a very good comparison at all.
Something that you just mentioned, which is something else that you're a big advocate of, is upgrading and updating your ride perpetually.
Yes.
And which is something that we don't think about, is I guess getting a new car all the time, or you know, getting a new lease.
Yeah, it is, it's a depreciable asset. Yes, it's an asset, but it depreciates the second you drive it off, and we know all of that. But financing has become much more easy in the regard that you can stretch out that payment over 8 years now. And who keeps a car for 8 years? Like, who really keeps a car for 8 years? And the Financial Consumer Agency of Canada really is taking exception to this as well, saying, look, guys, like, they've got some great calculators on canada.ca just to see how you can pay it off quicker, because you don't want to be taking on that 8-year debt. And it's so interesting that we hear all the time about the latte factor and cutting back, and all these personal finance educators, including myself, will say, hey, here's where you can cut your expenses. But if you just don't make these big money mistakes, like getting a car too often, or not paying down your mortgage principal, or not negotiating, or things of that sort, and you look at those dollar amounts, you can have your latte every single day. You can, you know, go out for dinner more with your friends and family. So it's stopping and saying, look, you know, with car share programs now in almost every city across Canada, does it make sense for you to have two vehicles as a family? Do you really need to get into that new car as quickly as you think, or could you hold on to it a little bit longer? So huge, huge expense that a lot of people just don't even think about.